Hello, everyone, and welcome to the AWN Fuse Effects panel. My name is Dan Sarto, and it's a pleasure to be with you here today. Let me start by introducing our two panelists. First, we have a visual effects supervisor and the head of 2D at Fuse Effects Los Angeles, Steve Meyer. And we also have the senior visual effects supervisor and the head of studio at Fuse Effects in Atlanta, Brad Kalinowski. Steve, Brad, welcome.
Thank you very much. Good to be here.
Thank you.
In terms of your main role in visual effects production, do you see it as more artistic, technical, or a mix of both? Do you usually find there's room for your personal creative touch on a project? And if so, kind of how do you bring that to the works?
Well, it's a good question. I think it's a little bit of both. There's two types of artists that I kind of classify people as. There's an artistic artist and then there's a technical artist. And it's nice when people have a good balance of both. And when it comes to supervising, I think it's, you kind of got to make your own roadways and production. Sometimes they just want you to answer their questions and just get the job done and push the buttons basically. But it kind of also depends on how early on you get into a production. Sometimes if you're on at the beginning and you can earn the respect of the crew, of the director, of the producers, they kind of give you a little bit more leeway to use your creative and to give your creative input. So one of the things is if you get into a production early on, you're able to earn the respect of the crew and the director. And then they kind of give you a little bit more leeway. Like I just recently did a show where I was kind of taking over, finding all the background plates and doing it all virtually. And pretty soon I was the guy. And so I had the writer calling me up saying, where are we going to put this location? What's the address? Because I kind of took over and they allowed me to kind of run with that and kind of be in charge of the backgrounds for the show.
Yeah, I think Steve said it pretty well. I mean, it's like, you know, it's a balance of both. If you're balancing both and you can win over the director and the production overall, then they tend to give you a little bit more control and they and trust because you have this balance of artistic talent and the technical talent, you know. I mean, I'm working with Step Up right now, and I've won the director over pretty well. And at this point, I'm literally directing the shots for him based on just my technical know-how and my artistic vision to help him get his vision, you know. You know, I think that's where the two kind of meet and how it helps.
Has it been your experience that the tighter the schedule and sometimes the less experience maybe the directors or the producers have working with visual effects, that they may trust you more kind of to bring your vision to how something can be produced because there's an assumption that you can bring it more than they might even be able to visualize it.
Absolutely. I think I've always loved working with young directors, the new kids on the block, because they tend to let the experts do what they do. So when they bring me on, we have a conversation. They're like, hey, I don't know much about visual effects. I'm just getting going. But I know how to tell a story. So you tell me what I need to do to get this shot or get what I need to make this a good show.
Yeah, I think that's right. You know, I've been on shows where there's the newest of directors who want you to kind of hold hands with them, you know, through the whole entire process. Yeah. And then you have those the one I'm working with on Step Up, Damien, who has been through a lot of different shows and has a lot of experience on variations of types of shows, but still he likes the artistic vision that I have, but also the technical side of things, understands the technical side of things.
Brad, this is directed at you. The birth of facial motion capture is a celebrated moment in visual effects history. Can you tell us about your first involvement with this process and what it has helped you achieve?
Yeah, my first job in Hollywood actually was at a place called Pacific Tunnel Mirage, which actually you know, Dave Altano. It's where we first met, the owner of Fuse FX. And basically what I was working on was a R&D version of facial motion capture that went on to be used in shows like Spider-Man and Lord of the Rings. It went on to be used as white papers, but also a basis for a lot of the facial motion capture that's being used today.
Where is its place in your visual effects toolkit, so to speak? Where do you find you're using it, and where is it extremely helpful?
It's kind of funny. I haven't really used it in a while, but it's, you know, I know overall, you know, it's being used more widely to for the creation of character of lifelike characters now, and it is in the toolbox for, I would say, more of the tentpole type of stuff. Would you say so, Steve?
Yeah, I think so. It's happening a lot because now we're doing a lot more digital double work and de-aging, that kind of process. Yeah. So it's we're starting to use it more and more to make those things more realistic and lifelike.
Steve, this is directed at you.
Yes.
You've worked on a noted plane explosion scene in Criminal Minds. What were the main challenges you faced producing the sequences?
For Criminal Minds, which was one of the most successful dramas on television, one of the characters was actually this plane that they used to get from Washington, from their location to wherever they were going to figure out who the bad guys were. So this plane was a big part of the series, and it probably appeared in more episodes than any of the actors. So in the series finale, they wanted to go off with a bang and actually blow up the plane. So we shot it at Van Nuys Airport out here, and it wasn't supposed to be that difficult of a sequence. We were going to shoot everything with the plane. There's a gunfight that happens out on the tarmac, and the plane taxis away, and then it blows up. And basically what we were going to do was just shoot everything practically. And then at the moment that the plane actually blows up, we'd step on it with a full CG plane. So our detail didn't have to be that perfect, because it was going to be an explosion at that point when we'd see our work. Unfortunately, nobody really calculated how long it takes to reset a Gulfstream jet. So we're shooting there in the middle of the night, and you know, every time we had to do a new take, they'd have to back the plane up. They'd get out there, you know, their forklift truck or whatever, and they'd have to push the plane back, physically back, and we have to redo it all, start the engines up, do whatever. And it took a long time. So it was about 3 a.m. They're looking at me and they're like, we're not going to get to your stuff, because I needed to get plates. I needed to get, I had all this pyro set to get reflections and reactive light off the buildings and that kind of stuff. And they're like, we're not going to get to to your plates. And I'm like, okay, well, I'll make it work. And then about an hour later, they're like, you know what? We're not even going to get, you know, hardly anything else, because we're starting to see daylight. So several of the shots towards the end of the sequence were actually a CG plane, because we just never got to those shots. And then we had to kind of recreate everything. And it ended up being really good and very climactic and a good way to send the show off.
Do you on a set like that, do you have a t-shirt that says, I'll make it work?
That's kind of was my answer, because there was nothing else I could do. You know, it's like, you can't go back and reshoot in an airport. You know, it's like, okay, I don't know how I'm going to do it, but we're going to do it.
And you got it done.
Yes, we got it done. And, you know, clients are very happy, and, you know, they're actually sad, because like I said, it was kind of a character on the show. So.
This next question is directed at both of you. Brad, I'm going to start with you. We've been in a pandemic for close to 1 year now, which hopefully is coming to an end here soon. How have you each adjusted to producing visual effects from home? And then Brad, let's start with you.
Yeah, it's kind of, you know, coincidental, ironic, whatever you want to say. But, you know, I started my company when I came out to the East Coast called Exodus Effects. And our whole goal was, you know, we're going to work remotely. Everybody, you know, I had about 20 artists. And we did work remotely for about 3 or 4 years when we had it, or 3 years as my wife and I had the company open. A lot of people said, no, this is not doable. A lot of studios were saying, we can't give you work. It's just not doable. You can't do it. It'll never work. Well, then the pandemic rolls around and here we are, all of us are working from home. And to be quite honest with Fuse FX, you know, I joined Fuse FX January 1st of last year. You know, when the pandemic hit, as we were finishing DMZ for Ava DuVernay in March, that's when we started rolling mm-hmm. everybody at home.
Yeah.
And it was pretty seamless. I mean, I personally wasn't involved too much with, you know, because I didn't really have a full crew here yet because we were just getting started. But, you know, working on the shows that I did have here as a supervisor, I mean, it was pretty seamless. You know, it didn't really affect me other than I was pretty happy to have an office at home for a while.
Steve, what about for you?
Well, it was quite a change. You know, I tend to work a lot of hours and I'm gone quite a bit because I'm the head of 2D, but I can't do that full time because I need to have something creative to do. And that's why I also supervise shows. So it was a big change because I went from not being home that much to being home all the time. I have 5 children. So being around them all the time was amazing. You know, it's like, I kind of enjoyed the working from home environment. And, you know, I like to say my garden has never looked better and my grass has never been greener, but, there has been challenges with work when you're actually supervising a show and you need to, be with your team members and go by their desks and adjust shots and try different versions. You kind of lose that. It's really hard to do that stuff on a Zoom. First of all, you can't see things. I mean, it's not always going to be in real time. You don't get the body communication, you know, like I may not say something, but you can see it in my face, you know, and you kind of lose that. So there's been pros and cons. I mean, I like it. And when they do open up the state, I'd like to see more of a hybrid situation where we go in maybe 2 days a week and then we can work from home 3 days a week. And I think that would be, for me, that would be a good balance.
A lot. I think it's been good for a lot of people, but there's introverts and extroverts, you know, and some
yeah.
of them, you know, introverts love it. Extroverts are like, get me out of here.
Well, I think the people that have homes, own a home and have families, they enjoy it more. Cause I get to have dinner with my family, right? Even though I probably work more hours now at home because it's like, I'm never off. I'm always at the office. I'm still having dinner with my family every night. And I love that. Whereas like when you have younger artists who are single and live by themselves in an apartment somewhere, they're the ones who are kind of pulling their hair out because their work people that's their social life and they're missing out on it. You know,
to follow up, of all the things that you've had to adjust and do remotely, what are you most looking forward to, for whatever reason, to getting back to the old way that you did it when you were in the office?
Well, I look forward to just reconnecting with all the people that report to me, that I work with, because I'm trying to do performance reviews. I'm trying to reach out to everybody as a head of 2D. And I just kind of like check in. And a lot of times I'm just doing it by chat, you know, because I know they're busy and they can't really stop down. So I miss that. Just the camaraderie of walking around from desk to desk and people come to me, you know, into my office and they have a problem. We can talk about it. And so I just miss being able to just interact with the people that I work with, you know, and that's what I miss.
Yeah, for me, I mean, my office, we've been having people come in since October of last year, and it's been about half, and we give them a choice. Either they can work from home or they can come into the office, and those who have chosen to come into the offices, you know, we've been
We haven't had any COVID whatsoever, but yeah, you know, having people in the office and actually being able to have that connection and that rapport and everything is really, really, honestly, I don't ever see that will go to a point in this industry of just everybody works from home. Because I think there needs to be that kind of rapport between artists and supervisors.
Yep. In CSI, there was a frozen moment scene that made visual effects history.
Yeah.
What role did you play in that production, and what did it mean for the future of visual effects at that time?
Okay. We're going back to about 2009, I think. And it was an exciting project. What we did was we incorporated I think it was about 2 minute long frozen moment scene for the series premiere of CSI that year. At the time, I was working as a head of 2D at another facility, and we realized when this project came in that it was a kind of a really big deal, and it was going to get a lot of publicity and stuff. And they asked me if I wanted to jump back. I was a flame artist earlier than before I became the head of 2D there. And I was excited. I'm like, I want to get in on this. I want to work on this shot, because up to that time, you hadn't seen that on the small screen. Everybody knows the frozen moment from the Matrix movies. And that's kind of where it was born. And that's kind of where it stayed, except you'd see snippets of where they, in commercials and things like that, where they'd have like 100 cameras set up around somebody and they jump up and they'd use snippets like that. Whereas we were going to do this long two minute thing where it's all a frozen moment going through these rooms and up to another floor. So my role was, I jumped in on the flame, and I was the lead compositor, comp supervisor, whatever you want to call it in that situation. And I basically needed to stitch all the plates, because they shot this with a series of motion control plates. So I had several people working for me that were kind of putting in all the CG elements and removing all the rigging and the poles holding things up. And then it was my job to take all that stuff, put it together in that one nice seamless package. It was very, very difficult, because it was so long, and not only the computers were having a hard time keeping up because of the volume of frames, and we were losing money. I mean, the company lost a lot of money on it, but it was successful. It turned out really well, and it got recognized by the VES Society and the Television Academy. It won some awards. And then it also opened up the door. Like I said, you'd only seen that kind of a look on the Matrix. And then there was one other commercial that had done something that we kind of mirrored off of, where the camera goes through the lab that the CSI people are working on. And there's a gunfight, and you see the bullets in the air and in slow motion and stuff. And it brought that to the small screen. And then after that, it was like the thing. So everybody was trying to jump on that bandwagon. And I got a lot of calls. They're like, we want to, we got this project. We want to use the guys that did the CSI open. So it became more commonplace. And the way you did it got more refined. And you just started seeing it more and more.
Brad, this is a question for you. You grew up in small town West Virginia and used to be a nurse.
Yep.
How did you find yourself working in visual effects? What made you leave nursing? What made you venture into visual effects? And what path brought you to the VFX space?
Yeah, I did grow up in a small town. I mean, I was born in a small town of about 50 people in West Virginia. My dad was a coal miner, so I'm a coal miner's son. We had 3 television stations back in the day. So there's one television station on a Saturday Saturday night at 11:30 PM would come on, and it was called Chiller Theater, and it would have Bela Lugosi or, it would have Godzilla versus King Kong and all that stuff, you know. So my dad would wake me up, have a deep sleep at me at 5 years old or whatever, and we'd sit on the couch until 3 a.m. in the morning watching monster movies. That's what I always wanted to do, you know. But being from West Virginia, you know, and not really having, you know, the means to go to film school or anything like that, you know, I went to nursing school, and computers were one of my things too. You know, I was taking Pong apart in 1972 when I was 6 years old, you know, so figuring out how it worked. And so, you know, later on in life, all of these things started coming together in the 80s and 90s, you know, and 2000s. And so I found myself in nursing just saying, this is not really what I want to do. And just by pure coincidence, I met a couple of guys who had, who were from West Virginia and had actually left West Virginia and went to California and London. One of my friends, which was my wife's cousin, had worked with Chris Tucker learning how to do, and he did all the makeup effects and the majority of the makeup effects for the Cantina and Star Wars. And so my buddy had learned how to do that. And then I met another guy who had worked for Paramount and had just come back to West Virginia. And when I was talking to them, things just kind of fell into place. And I quit my nursing job, spent 6 months learning how to do CG, learning how to do compositing. Went out to LA, and my first job was, because I had a little bit of a computer science background, my first job was at Life of Pacific Tidal Mirage Life Effects. And that was R&D for facial motion capture. And we were really building it for Warner Brothers' remake of The Incredible Mr. Limpet. And I think everybody in Hollywood was at one point in time involved in that, but we seemed to be the go-to people at the time. And we were working with Mark Brown and a bunch of guys, you know, from Warner Brothers to create this software so we could do it. You know, eventually it was just too expensive. It took too long. But anyway, that's how I ended up in Hollywood. And once that kind of fell through, the company Life Effects went away. I rolled into compositing and then supervision, and, you know, 102 films later and 26 years later, here I am.
Is there anything that you can look back on your nursing career and say to yourself, that has made me a better visual artist? Other than if someone's over, you know, fucking their chest.
Yeah, well, that's the good thing. I can take care of anything on set, that's for sure. And sometimes when the artists have a heart attack when you ask them to do something. Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, when you're working as a nurse, you know, and I worked in ER and in the trauma unit, I worked on the cardiac care floor. I worked on a bunch of floors, neonatal intensive care. And, you know, I mean, learning how to deal with people's, you know, the diversity in the people's, what do you say? You know, they're just, you know, everybody's not the same. You know, they all have different reasons for being pissed off or the reasons for being happy. So, you know, you kind of learn how to have that bedside manner and handle those kind of egos, I would say, you know, and with directors, first time directors, especially, and directors that are in production that hasn't done visual effects, you know, if you can really explain it to them in layman's terms and on terms that they can understand, and if something's happening and they're running out, they're like Steve said, you know, when they couldn't shoot the plane, and just, you know, dealing with everybody's panic state, you know, I think nursing in the medical field helped me deal with a lot of that.
Communication, interpersonal.
Yeah, exactly.
How to handle a scene.
Pretty much. Yeah. So, I mean, you know, for me, I don't regret it at all, being in nursing for 10 years, but, you know, it's definitely not something that I would want to go back to unless I had to.
What advice would you give to aspiring visual effects professionals?
Don't do it. No, I'm kidding.
You may work a lot of hours. No, actually, my biggest advice to, young aspiring visual effects artists and even people who have been in the business for a while that I manage is to always be a student of the craft. Always keep your eyes open. And when I say that, it's like I tell them, buy some photography magazines or art books or something like that, and just look at it. Just look at how pictures are. And like when you go outside, and you're walking to your car, take a look at it. If it's a sunny day, look at the shadows from the, like how are the shadows falling on the car? How are or underneath the car? How are the shadows by the wheels? You know, is it, you know, because anybody can put a dark shape down there, but the shadows are more complicated because it's getting light from different angles. And I tell them, it's like when you look off in the distance, look to see how the mountains fade off in depth, and just look at the colors. How do the colors fade? So if they surround themselves with magazines and they see all these different photographs, they get an understanding of what makes something real. So when they're working on a shot, you know, you could have some crazy space alien or something like that, but if they're not integrated into the scene with the right color balance and the right shadows, it's never going to look right. It's never going to look real. So they need to know what makes something look real. And that's what I say, you know, it's like, can you make CG look photoreal? And that's all about color balance, light fall off, shadows. So basically, I mean, in my short answer is just keep your eyes open around everything around you and see how nature treats it.
When you're doing a shot or you're setting up a shot or your composite or even CG, that there's atmosphere between us and it. It's never always crisp and clean and 100%. And, you know, the direction of light and the light bouncing off the walls, just learn a lot about color, learn a lot about light and how that interacts. Because, you know, this orange that's on my monitor is reflecting on me, but then I've got white over here that's reflecting on me, and everything's not always perfect. And that's another thing too, is like a lot of people try to make a lot of new artists anyway. I Steve, you can correct me, you know, but I think new artists that I see are always trying to make things hyper-realistic, and nothing is hyper-realistic except in the CG world. If you're, you know, it's all got to be, there's always these nuances, learning about the nuances of things, that everything's not perfect.
Right. Right.
You know, how to treat your objects and your images with light wrap and the proper light wrap and the right amount of light wrap. And that, you know, I think it's mainly about, you know, just like you said, like getting a lot of photography magazines and understand about the setup and what makes a photograph actually look real. You know, what is it? And specifically something right. that's not treated by Photoshop, you know, but, you know.
Right.
I've got a few kind of short answer questions to ask you, and directed to both of you. Mm-hmm. And the first one we're going to begin with is the same question I just asked you, but if you've got a sentence or two, what advice would you give to aspiring visual effects professional? Brad, why don't we start with you?
Try to learn all of it, not just one specific branch of visual effects, but all of it. 3D compositing, lighting, rigging, all of it. Because at some point in time, I think we're all going to, you know, we're going to be looking for artists that can do a variety of things as opposed to just one.
Okay, my sentence would just be to keep your eyes open at everything around you and how light is, how light and shadows and color make things look real.
What is your favorite film?
My favorite film has always been, since the day I saw it, Jaws. Just because of the music, the editing, love everything about it.
Brad, what about you? What's your favorite film?
To specify one, I guess it would have to be Blade Runner.
Can you point to any film where the visual effects completely blew you away?
One with Tom Hanks.
Forrest Gump?
Yes, thank you. Thank you. Yeah, Forrest Gump. That really is
good one,
because it was so seamless, and I really think that was a stellar film, honestly.
For a seamless visual effect, Forrest Gump is definitely one of the best. For something that's not so seamless, my favorite would have to be Inception. just, you know, there were no boundaries. It was a dream world, and they get to do whatever they want, but it still has to look real. So definitely Inception.
If you could work with any director or artist on your dream project, who would it be?
Considering that Jaws is my favorite movie and I've loved every movie he's done, it would have to be Spielberg. But I also really respect and admire the work that Ron Howard does. So either one of those guys would be my dream director to work with.
I worked with Spielberg, so I can't say that. I worked with George Lucas and all of them. I honestly, that's really hard to say. I mean, I honestly like any director that is up and coming, to be quite honest. And I don't have a specific director that I could point out or point to. I would love to work with Spielberg and Lucas again, and those guys that I've worked with before. I don't have a specific individual that I would love to work with, because I've worked with so many that are really, really good, honestly.
There's any one thing in the work that you do day in, day out that gives you the most personal sense of satisfaction, what would that be?
I think it's when, as a team, we deliver, you know, the amazing shots that we do for various shows that we do, you know? I mean, for me, this whole entire thing, for me, I mean, I get a kick out of just seeing the entire crew working together cohesively, and then when we deliver something, we see it up there, and it's a hit, you know, and it looks really good. And that's what I kind of get a kick out of. I mean, I've been doing this for 26 years, and I did nursing for 10, so that, you know, I love this every day, and nothing really turns me off about it. You know?
Well, my answer would have been different if you had asked me this a year ago. But seeing as how we're a year into this pandemic, and seeing the number of people who have emailed me or called me over the past year looking for work, and now that I'd always say, check with me in a month, check with me in a month. So the thing, as the head of 2D, and I'm in charge of hiring at FuseFX for our 2D department, the thing that I love doing is when we can actually extend an offer to somebody, because they are so grateful, and they just come in, they're motivated, and they are ready to work and just prove themselves. And I just love to hear the excitement in their voice when they finally get a job.
You know, I don't think I've ever had anybody answer that question that way. Mm-hmm. And that's a fantastic answer. That's really, you know, as you say it, I can feel it. You know, I can hear it, and that's really great.
It broke my heart all summer just getting these emails from all these artists that who've crossed my path over the last, you know, 20 years or whatever. People just come out of the woodwork, and then when you can actually say, "Hey, I got something for you," that's a good feeling for both of us.
Yeah, you can hear them pop the champagne cork. So.
Yeah.
Well, it looks like that's all the time we have today. And I really want to thank Steve and Brad. I want to thank you for joining us and sharing your great insights into the great work you guys have been doing at FuseFX and at other places in your career. I also want to thank Impact 24 PR and Animation World Network for putting this panel together, and to all of you for joining us as we delve deep into the world of television VFX production. And on behalf of everyone, until next time.